Well, thank you so much for that incredible, actually, two presentations. That was amazing. Yeah.
Did you notice how I used every word as a stain on silence and nothingness to segue into Siloam?
That was genius.
The book absolutely just came out.
So one thing that you didn't really get into too much in your talk, and something that I felt very strongly about from the first time I read your work, is that I know you feel that, you know, you escaped from the Jewish traditions in some ways, right? But I do feel that you are so deeply embedded in that world in terms of all of your work. And I mentioned in the introduction about Midrashic interpretation, and I see that in your work. And one thing that Midrash does, if you recall from your bar mitzvah lessons many years ago, which I know you enjoyed very much, you told me about that and wish you could have that again. But it's interesting that Mouse took 13 years to write, don't you think?
I thought that was interesting,
it is,
too.
Right? So one thing that Midrash does is it takes an older biblical story, let's say, and it completes and extends it while creating a new story. And I think that's sort of what we see in so much of your work, is that you're doing this sort of thing.
I actually was thinking about that in that page that I showed you with all the arrows.
Yes.
Because, you know, like the Midrash is written in layers of commentary. Mm-hmm. I only learned about it by looking at old Aztec codexes. It came not from my tradition, but from that I was led back to seeing a page of the Midrash, which has the Bible text in the center, rabbis from one century talking, other rabbis arguing with them. It really is like Mad Comics, you know? It basically is a self-referential dialogue, ultimately.
Absolutely, and that is what a page of Talmud looks like, which is essentially what you've done quite a bit. Actually, like you mentioned, the style of many of the panels and how they fit together does that. And one of the things that style does is it doesn't even really privilege the original story, but it makes the interpretations equal to it because it's all together sort of on the page. And I think that's something that we see in your work.
Well, the whole world of art and letters is now Jewish because it's all about, in the postmodern moment, one quotes from everything to make what one makes. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I was proudest of was when the book first came out, and I was amazed to find that it got onto the bestseller list, mm-hmm. but it came out and went onto the nonfiction, onto the fiction bestseller list, right? And I went, well, that sucks, but I wrote a letter to the Times saying, well, gee, if I'm sure George Lincoln Rockwell would be delighted to find out that what happened to my father was fiction, if he could read. But ultimately, the publisher listed it as nonfiction, and because I have a friend who was an art director at the Times, he came and told me about all the debates that went on in their offices, and one guy was adamant. He just said, no, look, why don't we all go to Spiegelman's house? If a giant mouse answers the door, it's on the nonfiction list immediately. But for me, it's all fiction, nonfiction. It's all a blur at this point. You know, like, I mean, look at the debates that we're missing. There's absolutely no line where you can say, this is a fact, and that's the end of it. And then you see the video footage saying it's a fact, and it doesn't penetrate, because we all have facts the way we have favorite records. You know, it's different.
Well, you know, I do think that your work is very midrashically oriented in that sense.
It's not my usual frame of reference, but I know what you mean.
Yeah.
See, I'm very...
You're so amenable. That's amazing. Yeah. You just agree to that like that.
But I think that it has to do with the fact that the Jewish tradition I relate to most is the alienated diaspora cosmopolitan Jew who doesn't feel at home anywhere. And the closest I could come to genuinely feeling Jewish was instead of being a ruthless cosmopolitan, which is what Stalin called our people, I found that after September 11th, I was a rooted cosmopolitan. I loved something about New York and was willing to acknowledge that.
Well, you know, that's really interesting. I wanted to transition to In the Shadow of No Towers, because in Mouse, you have this conversation with Françoise, and you're saying in that conversation that you know, it sounds crazy, but you have this recurring dream and desire to say that you wish you were actually in the camps with your parents, because then you would actually know what they went through. And I know exactly what you mean, even as a third generation person. It's something that I often think about when I contemplate what my grandparents went through. And yet here you were now, let's say 15 years or so after Completing Mouse on 9/11 in New York City. And of course, they're not comparable. I'm not saying they are, but yet you have your own massive tragedy with death all around you. You see these buildings coming down.
That was kid stuff. You know, I was aware that I was carrying, you know, ever since Mouse came out, I have this giant rat chasing me all over the world. And it had to do with knowing that people come to me expecting me to be doing Mouse again. And instead it would be like, well, it's good, but it's not Mouse. But then as Joseph Heller said about Catch-22, no, but what is? And the thing was that I was aware of those thoughts going through my head, among many others. But I also knew that this was a relatively minor tragedy that I was just in the midst of, and I was worrying about my daughter being caught in the buildings because she just started high school right next to the World Trade Center. But I somehow both had perspective and lost all perspective at the same time. So September 12th came about November. And that's when I really started doing In the Shadow of No Towers.
Well, you know, that brings us back to Cy Lewin, I think, that the violence of that day on American soil. And I think back to that image of that Cy Lewin painted of this bucolic image of Central Park, which, of course, for him was this nightmare vision. And I'm wondering how much of that beautiful space of Central Park, and of course, how all of art, Western civilization in some ways, he just left the Met, right? Now he's going through here and leads to this horrible, vicious beating that he takes, right? And that haunted him throughout his life. And yet his message in the parade was one of, you know, the horrors of war and violence and the effects of that on our generation. So maybe you could talk a little bit about that today, especially how important his vision is.
When I was talking to Cy a little bit before I gave him the book on the phone, I was saying, so are you a Bernie man? Not Burning, but a Bernie Sanders man. He said, hey, seems like an intelligent fella, but I have to vote for Hillary. I said, what? Why? You once told me you were to the left of Karl Marx. And he said, yeah, but if we don't have a matriarchy, we're doomed. So I took it to heart and reconciled myself to having to vote for lying Hillary. But I thought this was an amazing thing because the book ends with a mother embracing a child before the next generation of children are marched off by their parents to become cannon fodder again.
Very powerful image, and what an incredible book. So I think we should open this up. I'm sure there are a lot of questions from the audience, so why don't we do just that?
Hi, I appointed myself the first, I guess, question asker, because I literally just got up because I wanted to stand up, and I'm like, oh, there's a microphone here. Oh, convenient. I just want to ask you, obviously you've been doing this a long time, and a lot of people here are aspiring artists and writers and filmmakers. Is there any aspect of the creative process or of being an artist that you feel gets overlooked a lot? Like something people don't talk a lot about, but you wish they would?
Yeah, well, I was asked in a class this morning what I did about, like this person was describing her blockage as an artist, like just wanting to throw it against the wall and forget it, you know?
Yeah.
And I would say this is like a daily occurrence. I start by throwing things out and starting again. It brings to mind a friend of mine, a writer, who defines a writer as somebody who enjoys having written. And that's pretty much what it feels like. And there are tricks you can do to get yourself past it, because basically, as my friend Linda Barry, a great cartoonist, who some of you may know her work, so she says, like, the main problem is you have this voice that develops inside your head. Every kid draws naturally. But then so you start asking yourself, so is this good or does it suck?
Yeah.
And the idea is to get those voices out of your head long enough to just put something down and not look back. Wasn't that the Dylan line that he's probably singing across town right now? Like, she's an artist, she don't look back. And I think what it means is being free of it long enough so you can see it as if somebody else did it. And that can be as fast as 3 days later. But don't judge it, and that's really hard to do. I have a hanging judge who's just like always there and just saying, oh, sucks, it sucks.
Right.
And you gotta like find ways to muzzle it, and that's part of what I think every artist needs to know. But the things that I learned in school that I didn't think were useful, like there's a book that all of us kids, when I went to a vocational art high school, not to learn to be an artiste, like those fakers in that crumb drawing, but to learn how to do, you know, layouts, paste up, mechanicals, even architecture, you know, applied arts of one kind or another. And there's a book we had to read called, It was called The Natural Way to Draw by Nicolaides. And this was a book that every art student got at a certain moment. And it said, first thought, best thought. Mm-hmm. And I tried it and I thought, you know, that's almost as bad advice as it's only lines on paper, folks, because sometimes the first thought is the best thought and sometimes the hanging judge is right. It sucks. Yeah. Do it again. But the idea is to stay out of the way of the hanging judge long enough to make something, and that's probably an important thing. And then another thing that you people will have to learn, and I thought I was going to learn, and Cy did learn, is that making art and making money aren't necessarily the same thing. We're living in a moment now that's just insane. I mean, I'm not talking about tonight, but I'm talking about the idea that, like, the word artist, which my wife told me you're never allowed to call yourself in her French upbringing. Mm-hmm. You can say you're a painter, but an artist is something that's conferred on you, you know? Mm-hmm. And basically, they've redefined it. Like, now when we hear these editors talking about working for new media and stuff, they used to call us content providers. And now they've even changed that word to now we're just called assets. I mean, cartoonists were always called asses, but like now everybody who does something creative just happens to be an asset for somebody who can own them. And as a result, people get paid less and less and less for the same endeavor of turning yourself inside out to entertain others, you know? And this is an issue that I can't solve. It seems to me that those of you who have embraced the reality of working on the web, which I can understand if I was younger and was stupid enough to want to become a cartoonist again, I would basically have to work that way. And it's one of the few routes to success, because basically some people are able to accrue people who care about what they do, and it leads to things like Patreon. And what it really leads to is if you have a prefab audience, the poor panicked publishing industry wants you because they don't know how to find an audience. But if you have 80,000 people who are following this thing that you put up online, anybody will publish you. Whatever it is. And so there are still ways through for cartoonists, writers. Musicians just have to have very good t-shirts. it's still possible. But it's stranger than it ever was.
Okay. Thank you so much for your time. I'll open it up to this guy.
I suppose I speak for everybody here when I say thank you for holding this event. We appreciate it.
Well,
my question for you is... how have you been enjoying El Paso so far?
I was here this morning, this afternoon. You have a very nice campus with its, what is it, Bhutanese temples or something here. But all I got to see was that in the distance there's Juarez, and I wanted to go over there before there was a wall. And I just haven't had time, damn it. I figured I wouldn't even mention Trump tonight because I was afraid that fire marshals would be snitched to, that there were too many people in the room. And I just don't know where everybody stands. I now found that one more time, I'm only allowed in the blue zone. My passport doesn't extend to red America. I'm only invited to like blue little corners of the map of the US. So I just thought I was going into, Mars. Thoroughly red planet, but here you are.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, thank you for coming. This next question, if I may ask, it's about your relationship with your father during the process of you making your book. Is that okay? Okay. So I read your book when I was in sixth grade, and my sense was as you were interviewing your father, you had tons and tons of patience with him, because like there's points in the book where I'm like, how does this dude deal with his father? Like, how does he not want to strangle him? So my question is, when you were writing your graphic novel, your novel, whatever you would like to call it,
comics
Did your relationship improve or get on the rocky side, or how would you say your relationship changed with your father during the process?
Well, I think one thing that made the book possible is I'd been this hippie. I had a button that said, don't trust anybody over 30. I was approaching my 30th birthday. As I told the class this morning, I thought I should be dead in a motorcycle accident by 30, but I never even focused enough to learn how to ride one badly. I'm going to stick around. I should do something ambitious. And so I didn't know what it was going to be. I had a few different ideas, and one of them was to do something called A Life in Ink. That was going to be a life of a fictional cartoonist who lived through the first 100 years of comics in the form of a box with booklets of different works that he had done, of his diaries, and things like that, artifacts. And that seemed hard. Now it would just be called normal. But then I thought I'd move back to New York from San Francisco. I was still doing what I'd done before, which is, from the time I moved back, I learned something in the Dick Tracy Crime Stopper, little corner panels at the top of each Sunday strip. And it said that if crooks put a towel over the receiver, it would sound like long distance. So I would call my father, ask how he was doing, and pretend that I was living in San Francisco for about a year plus after I was living here. And then eventually I realized I'm going to have to see him at some point. So that was what leaned me toward picking up the unfinished business of that first three-page mouse. And what was amazing to me is as soon as we returned to these interviews I'd made when I visited him in 1972, all of a sudden we had common ground that didn't involve you should become a doctor. If not a doctor, then a dentist, because in Auschwitz, dentists were doctors too. And then he would say things like, he did things like throw out my coat, you know, just the usual stuff. And as soon as we were on this turf, it was no longer get a haircut. It was more like we both had a place to talk. And so in some really weird way, Auschwitz became our safety zone. I know it's weird. But it did. And that allowed us to have a reason to be together. And so when I finished whatever he could tell me, I'd go back and we'd start again. And I'd try to get past something that at first I resented him for, but I realized is true for everybody. Once you've said something, you no longer have the memory. You have having said the memory, right? And every time you revisit a memory, it distorts further. So the stories he's told to his friends who also went through the camps, to Anja, to whoever, he had those stories. But the things he hadn't said, it was very hard to get him to find. So we'd go over it over and over again, and I was gleaning for extra details. Because, you know, a novelist can say, we marched to work. And I'd have to say, was it past big buildings or one-story high buildings? Did you march in groups of four or six? And a writer can bluff if he wants to and get away with it much easier, you know? Although Hemingway once said, you can write that a man was fishing in a boat, but you have to know what kind of tackle he used and what kind of boat, even if you just say a man was fishing in a boat. And cartoonists have to prove it. You know, you need to like inhabit everything. And not only were there no watches in Auschwitz, there were no photographers to speak of. What was really an important influence on me that I didn't get to show tonight, but it is in MetaMouse, is some of the artwork by that survived, that was made in the camps at great risk. That survived. And those things helped me understand what things actually looked like. So that was an area where we kept being able to be together, you know? And yes, he still drove me nuts, but, you know, my joke about it is just that after he died, my relationship with him got a lot better. And in a way, it's kind of true, because now I have bought what other people say. It says, oh, it's a book of your love affair with your father. And in some ways it is, but it was so thwarted that it was impossible to find. So it was a difficult relationship. My generation had a generation gap. Me and my father had a generation chasm, you know? So there it was.
Well, thank you so much for
thank you.
Doing your process with your father and making your book on behalf of everybody here.
Thanks.
Maybe two more questions?
I guess it might be like a question and a half. The first one is, will you be signing books afterwards?
Excuse me?
Will you be signing books afterwards?
No. I really can't. You don't understand what my last 72 hours have been like.
And
the problem with signing books, that's why I signed a bunch in advance, is I like it if that's the event, but it really is an intense event. It's like speed dating. And it's so intensely exhausting. And if I break down because I want to be liked like everybody else, after like 18 or 19 90-second sessions of trying to connect with people, I find it very hard to keep doing it. So if I sign one book, then I'm not free until I've signed like a lot. Okay. So maybe someday I'll come back for a signing, but I can't do it as part of doing an afternoon class, a talk, sleeping in the smallest room I've ever slept in an airport because I missed the plane, at the Minute Suites at the Dallas airport where you rent them by the minute. It's very expensive for an overnight while waiting for my morning flight here. But since they charge by the minute, they should have charged me half because I only slept half the night in this ridiculously tiny... I'm sorry, I'm just going into my shit at this point. But I really would find it hard to like be able to keep doing it. I apologize, but I need to ask for clemency.
But there are many books that are signed already outside, and those are for sale from the bookstore as you exit behind towards the...
They're gone?
Wow. That's amazing. They're all gone.
Thank you. But you know, although I am insanely busy for 3 weeks more, trying to promote the Cy Lewin book, among other things, if you send me a book plate in a pile of 50 or 100 or whatever, I'll sign those and they can put them in their own.
That sounds great. We'll definitely do that. All right. Thank you. Maybe one more question from the audience?
No, that wasn't...
Sure.
Oh, did you have an actual question?
That was a half question.
Okay, let's take that first.
But my real question was, at this point now, after going through all this, after all these years, after writing Mouse and then going through that process with your father, have you forgiven both your father and your mother? Because in Mouse, you displayed heavy emotions. You even featured a comic where features your mother's suicide. And he says, thank you for making me this prisoner. So at this point now, have you forgiven both of them?
Yeah, which I might have gotten to anyway, having outlived them by decades. But shit, my brain has turned into silly putty. I'm ready to forgive the Germans.
Now that's the Art Spiegelman we all expected here, okay? You've been so well behaved. All right, maybe one more question.
Hi, Mr. Spiegelman, thank you for doing this. My question is, Mouse was really the first comic to break into academia. Do you feel there's a comic before that or after that deserves the same kind of scrutiny?
Yeah, and it's beginning to happen now. There's lots. You just have to comb through tons of shit to find it, but it's there. It's like every other medium, actually, and for me, I've always been... I have a certain kind of diseased form of nostalgia, which is everything before my birth is really interesting. And so I just found myself fascinated by old newspaper comics of 19th century cartoon and caricature magazines. And I like to say now that the future of comics is in the past. There's so much we didn't absorb from the great comics. And they're a great source of inspiration for me and for a lot of the cartoonists I know. Because there's things like that are all being reprinted now. It's the first time comics really have a history. It's a history based on a canon that cartoonists have made, when nobody was interested. But as a result, it's hard to look at Winsor McCay's Little Nemo and not see it as one of the great works of art of the early 20th century. And now they're published in books that are as big as the original newspaper pages, literally that big. There's many different editions of it, in fact. Crazy Cat is sublime and remains sublime and was actually always considered sublime, unlike the comics around it. I can't really give you that lecture until I come back and do a lecture here on that old comics, but won't have enough energy to sign afterwards yet again. But there's so many. Plastic Man is one of the great achievements in the comic books. Harvey Kurtzman really is some kind of genius. The guy who did that Master Race story, Bernie Krigstein. And now these people, you can find out about them by looking around on the web. And one of the problems I had a few years ago is I was made the president of the Angoulême French Comics Festival, which is an important thing, and I had to have a retrospective of my work. And that was in the Angoulême Paris Publishers part of this coming together in a small town and having an exhibit. I didn't want that, but I had to ultimately agree after they were able to find other venues for it besides a small town that has 300,000 people for about 4 days and then nobody for the rest of the year. And I then said, well, why don't we also have a show at the other museum in town, which is run by the Angoulême School of Animation and Comics. It has a very good archive of original art. They gave me a blank check to do that alternative show. And I used three or four different collections to make my ideal museum of comics that about 300,000 people had access to, and then nobody, because nobody was around to see it. And I'd done it so quickly, there was no chance to get it to travel. And I really regret it, because it was an amazing thing. But at a party during the Angoulême Festival, this young cartoonist, who's now getting some renown, comes up and is talking to me. She was a visiting artist at the time. And I said, have you seen this show yet? Because they had the opening before I got to town in order to not quarrel with the Publishers Festival, because these two different entities got along like Palestinians and Israelis. And I'd really started a shooting war when I wanted to bring them both together. So I said, have you seen that show? It's an amazing show. It had nothing to do with my work except my curating and finding the things to show. She said, you're really interested in that old stuff, huh? And I did a double take. It's as if I said I was interested in butterfly collecting or something. Worked for Nabokov, but it's not a natural. And here it seems so natural to do that sort of thing. And she didn't have it. So I went to a young cartoonist of her generation and said, what's with that chick, you know? Is she crazy? He said, no, Art, you just don't understand. We're living in a sampling culture. Winsor McKay and Robert Crumb were born at the same time. And it is a way to work. I can't understand it. I see things in terms of use value as well as appreciating them for what they are, which insists on knowing what time they were made so you don't get insulted by seeing race caricature or attitudes that aren't yours, to see what people did as living and breathing, throw away art that allowed you to live through the day that they were living through with them in the daily newspaper sections. And during my 9/11 moment, I took solace not in... who's the guy who wrote the poem that everybody was reading on 9/11? I'm blanking out. It was over and over again. It was the poem about destruction and war and... never mind. You don't know either. This is what Google was invented for. But in any case, this poem was being read on every news broadcast. And I found I could only take solace in the ephemeral, because that's what... if comics are structures, so are World Trade Center buildings. And the fact that they could disappear so easily, which I always hated them while they were around. It took 10 years for me to like them. I don't know. I mean, it's a matter of attitude. But I find that we're really lucky to have access to this now in such a relatively complete way. Almost everything I've loved has one or many books or archival editions of all of it coming out, as well as real and genuine histories. Oh. Wow, okay.
Thank you.
Well, you know, on behalf of UTEP, I think we could say we'll be happy to have you back here to do a signing or another talk. And
all
we'll
right,
definitely
we'll do it.
Take
then we go to
the border. There'll be right. No wall, I promise you that. That's not going to happen. We haven't even seen the debates, and we know that's not going to happen. But on
unless
behalf...
Hillary was pulverized into mortar, in which case... Okay,
well,
for the wall.
Everyone came here to avoid politics.
I'm sorry.
We are talking about that,
me
right?
Me too.
Okay, I know. It's
me
my,
too.
Yeah. So on behalf of UTEP and this wonderful audience, let's thank Art Spiegelman for coming here to UTEP. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. It's nice to meet you. Thanks. So I'll hang out as long as you don't ask me to sign and we can talk in the back or something like that. Thank you.